All right, this is day 37, and it's the assignment for April the 16th. And it deals with ionization energy, electronegativity, and atomic radius, all subjects that we've talked about before in class, as is everything that we're doing for the first 2 weeks here. This is a chance to review it, and this will count in as part of your fourth quarter grade, but it is all review material. So what is ionization energy? Ionization energy is the amount of energy that is required to pull an electron away from its atom. So the man represents ionization energy, and the ionization energy must pull on the electrons with more force than the protons pull on the electron. So it's kind of a tug of war, and if the little man can pull with more energy than the protons are pulling in, then that electron will be released. And that amount of energy is called the ionization energy. So the amount of energy the man must use to pull the electron away from the atom is the ionization energy. So ionization energies increase as you go up a group and as you go to the right in the period. So there is the right going from left to right in the period. A period is a row, and a group is a column. So as you go up, that also increases the ionization energy. So the highest ionization energies are in the upper right, and the lowest are in the lower left. So this next illustration, which is kind of a perspective view of the periodic table, doesn't show all of the elements, but you can see that the highest step there is helium, and that's where the highest ionization energy is. Helium is the most difficult to pull an electron away from of all the elements. Cesium in the lower left is easiest. It has the lowest ionization energy, and we're going to talk about why that is in just a second. So ionization energy is greater in the upper right-hand corner of the periodic table, where helium is located. Ionization energies are lowest when an electron is farthest away from the nucleus. That is to say, elements that have more orbitals, their valence electrons are farther away from the nucleus, and the nucleus has fewer protons. So let's take a look at those two. Let's take a look at the second one first. Lithium has a lower ionization energy for its electron than fluorine because lithium's valence electron is the same distance from the nucleus as fluorine's. In other words, they're both in the second row, so both of them have two orbitals. Now, even though fluorine has more electrons in its second orbital, that doesn't matter. They're all side by side. They can all see into the nucleus equally. Lithium, on the other hand, has only one electron in its second orbital, but again, that's not important. It is able to see into the nucleus. That one electron is able to see into the nucleus equally with fluorine's seven valence electrons. What's different is that lithium only has three protons pulling in on it, whereas fluorine has nine. So fluorine has a much greater positive charge pulling in on all those valence electrons, and therefore it's harder to pull a valence electron away from fluorine than it is from lithium. Lithium, it's much easier to take that one electron away from it. So let's read that again. Lithium has a lower ionization energy for its electron than fluorine because lithium's valence electron is the same distance from the nucleus as fluorine's, that is to say the second orbital. But lithium has only three protons to attract it, while fluorine has nine to attract its electrons. So that takes care of why the elements on the left have lower ionization energy than the ones on the right. Now what about up and down? Let's read the second box. Bromine has a lower ionization energy for its valence electrons than fluorine because it has more orbitals. That's a little bit easier to understand. So bromine's valence electrons are farther from the nucleus. So you can see the outer electrons in bromine are not only farther from the nucleus, but they have a lot of core electrons, those electrons inside, blocking the outside electrons from feeling the pull of the protons in bromine. So even though bromine has more protons, they're really shielded so that the outside electrons, the valence electrons, don't feel them very, very well. Whereas in fluorine, it doesn't have as many protons to pull in on the electrons, but there's very little shielding of the valence electrons, those outer electrons, from the nucleus of fluorine. And therefore, bromine has a lower ionization energy. It's easier to take those electrons away from the bromine atom. Okay, now we move on to electronegativity. What is electronegativity? Electronegativity is how much an atom wants to pull an electron towards it. And that is an atom that it doesn't originally own. It's an atom from another, it's an electron from another atom, or it's an electron that's just floating out in space. But electronegativity is how much an atom wants to pull an electron toward it from the outside. So the man in this case represents electronegativity, so he's pulling the electron in towards the atom and not pulling it away. Electronegativity is measured on a scale of 0 to 4 called the Pauling scale. Fluorine has the highest electronegativity, which is 4.0. So electronegativity increases as you go up a group and to the right in a period. So up a column or to the right in a row. You'll notice that's the same trend as ionization energy. So the highest electronegativities are in the upper right-hand side of the periodic table, and the lowest are in the lower left-hand side. So fluorine, oxygen, chlorine, sulfur really want to pull in electrons from the outside. Whereas cesium, barium, francium, radium do not want to pull in nearly as hard. So again, here's a perspective view of a kind of a three-dimensional view of it. So electronegativity is greatest in the upper right-hand corner of the periodic table where fluorine is, and it's lowest in the lower left. Now there is one exception, one difference between electronegativity and ionization energies. The elements on the right side of the periodic table are called noble gases. That would be helium, neon, argon, krypton, and so forth. Noble gases have no electronegativity because they already have a full octet and do not want additional electrons. We're going to learn about the octet rule a little bit later in this lesson, but you'll notice that the noble gases, the ones on the right-hand side of the periodic table, don't appear in this diagram here. They don't want to pull in any additional electrons. They're happy the way that they are. So electronegativities are highest when an electron is closest to the nucleus, that is to say it has fewer orbitals, because it feels the pull of the protons in the nucleus more strongly, and when the nucleus has more protons. So let's look at our example, same example that we use for ionization energy. Lithium has a lower electronegativity than fluorine because it has the same number of orbitals but fewer protons. So lithium doesn't pull on outside electrons as well as fluorine. Bromine has a lower electronegativity than fluorine because the bromine has more orbitals and more core electrons. Those are the electrons inside of the valence orbital. The nucleus is screened more, so it can't pull in electrons from the outside as well. So fluorine in the upper right-hand corner has the highest electronegativity. So electronegativity and ionization energy kind of sound like the same thing. They're how much an atom wants to pull on electrons. But ionization energy has to do with how much an atom wants to pull on its own electrons and hold on to them and not let them go, whereas electronegativity has to do with how much an atom wants to pull in outside electrons, electrons that don't originally belong to it. But the concept is kind of the same. Okay, so atomic radius. This is the third topic we're going to deal with. Our definition of atomic radius will be the distance from the center of the nucleus to the outermost electron. So atomic radius is the distance between the center of the nuclei, which is the plural word for nucleus, and the outermost electron. Basically, it's like the radius on a circle. It's the radius on a circle is the distance from the center of the circle to the perimeter of the circle. So atomic radius is important because some chemical properties depend on whether an atom can fit into a small space. There's a more technical definition of atomic radius, but we don't need to know it. This is really the definition that we can use. It's essentially how big is the atom. Okay, so atomic radius decreases as you go up a group and as you go to the right in the period. So this is a kind of an opposite trend of ionization energy and electronegativity. So the atomic radius, if you go up the group, that is up a column, it gets smaller. Now that makes sense because as you go up from the bottom of the top of the periodic table, down at the bottom you have atoms that have a lot of orbitals. And so they really expand outward and it makes the atom really big. But as you go up, you have fewer and fewer orbitals. The second row has two orbitals, the first row only has one orbital, and therefore the size of the atom becomes smaller and smaller as you go up. So that's kind of an easy one to understand. The one that's a little more challenging is why does the atomic radius decrease as you go from left to right? After all, let's take the second row as our example again. If you go from lithium across all the way to neon, by the time you get to neon, you have a lot more protons, a lot more neutrons, and a lot more electrons in neon than you do in lithium. So if you have a lot more of everything, why doesn't it become bigger rather than smaller? So let's go ahead and explain that. So atomic radius are highest when an atom has more orbitals, and that's what we just talked about. As you go down the periodic table, you add orbitals, the radius becomes bigger. So you see that bromine has more orbitals than fluorine, and therefore it has a bigger atomic radius. But the one that's a little more challenging to understand is why does fluorine have a smaller atomic radius than lithium, even though fluorine has a lot more protons, electrons, and neutrons? And the reason is that lithium has a larger atomic radius than fluorine because it has the same number of orbitals, they both have two orbitals, but fewer protons. So the lithium doesn't pull on the electrons as tightly as fluorine. So fluorine, even though it does have seven valence electrons in its outer orbital, that doesn't matter how many there are. They're all side by side. They're not blocking each other. So they're going to be pulled in by the nine protons that fluorine has. They're going to be pulled in a lot more tightly, and it's going to make the size of the atom smaller. Whereas lithium, even though it only has one electron in its second orbital, it only has three protons. And therefore, that electron is going to stay farther away from the nucleus because it's not being pulled on as hard. We can also go back and explain this using the Z effective number, the effective Z numbers. We calculated the effective Z number for lithium as 3 protons minus 2 core electrons equals 1. So the outer electron in lithium only feels the pull of 1 proton. Whereas in fluorine, you have 9 protons minus also only 2 core electrons, so 9 minus 2 is 7, so all of the valence electrons in fluorine feel the pull of 7 protons. So fluorine, the valence electrons feel the pull of 7 protons, that's a lot stronger, whereas in lithium, the valence electron only feels the pull of 1 proton, and therefore fluorine's electrons are pulled in tighter, and it has a smaller atomic radius. So as we move to the upper right-hand side, this is a summary of the three, as we move to the upper right-hand side of the periodic table, ionization energy and electronegativity increase while atomic radius decreases. Okay, so be sure you can explain why these things happen. It has to do with basically comes down to number of orbitals and number of protons in the nucleus. Okay, and this is a plot of atomic radius plotted against atomic number. So let me just explain what you're seeing here. You see a dot in the lower left, it's kind of a black dot, and that's either hydrogen or helium. That's in the first row. Now, as you go to the right, you see a series of yellow dots. The highest one, the one that's highest up, is lithium. and it has the largest atomic radius, and it's being measured in picometers, which is a trillionth of a meter. So it's saying that that dot, the first, the highest yellow dot, is, you can kind of guess, about 170 one trillionths of a meter. Now, as you go from left to right, we said the atomic radius becomes smaller. So the second yellow dot down would be beryllium, and then you have the other elements until the bottom yellow dot would be neon. Then all of a sudden, you've gotten to the end of the second row of the periodic table. Now you add another orbital and you jump up to that highest red dot. That would be sodium on the far left side of the periodic table. It has the biggest radius of any of the elements in the third row. And then as you go across, the radius gets smaller and smaller until you get to argon, which is that bottom red dot. And you can see the same type of progression for the third, fourth, and fifth rows. Now, why are there so many dots in the third, fourth, and fifth rows? We'll talk about that as a later time. But the principle is the same. As you go from left to right across the periodic table, the radius gets smaller and smaller because more protons are there to pull in the electrons. Okay, so here's yet another summary. So as you go across the periodic table, more protons As you go across a period row, more protons are added to the nucleus. The electrons are pulled in with greater force. This means that the atomic radius becomes smaller. The energy required to pull an electron out, ionization energy, becomes greater. And the ability to pull an electron in, electronegativity, also becomes greater. So know how these trends work, because they're very essential. It's very essential to know these for understanding chemical bonding. As we go down the periodic table, more orbitals are added. This makes the atomic radius larger, and the outer electrons are farther away from the nucleus. This increased distance from the nucleus makes both the ionization energy and the electronegativity less. In other words, they don't hang on to their electrons as well as you go down. An atom doesn't hang on to its electrons very well as you go down the periodic table, and it doesn't want to pull in outside electrons quite as much when you go down the periodic table. All right, now we're going to get into a very important rule in chemistry. It governs a lot of what we're going to talk about in chemistry. It's called the octet rule. Understanding why the octet rule works is not important, so don't worry about it thinking, I don't really understand why the octet rule works. Just accept it as a law of nature that does work, and it governs why chemical bonds take place. So you don't have to understand the mechanics of the octet rule, just understand how it's applied and how it's used. So the octet rule says that atoms are happy when they can fill their valence orbital. Octet means eight. It's called octet because all elements need eight electrons to fill their valence outer orbital. And that's true even of the ones down below on the periodic table. Every element requires eight electrons to fill its valence orbital. Noble gases such as helium and neon at the end of each row already have full valence orbitals. They're called noble because they have a full crown. They are royal, and other elements want to be like them. So you can see neon and helium there, both have full valence orbitals. Helium's in the first row, it only has one orbital, it can only hold two electrons because of that, and therefore it has a full valence orbital, its first orbital. Neon is in the second row, it has two orbitals. In order to fill its valence orbital, it has to have eight electrons. And so neon already has a full orbital, so it's very happy where it is. It has high ionization energy. It has no electronegativity because it doesn't want to take in any more electrons because it's happy. And you notice how it kind of looks like a crown. So that's the octet rule. And it's a very important principle. Just accept that it is the way it is and don't really worry about why do they want to have eight electrons. They just do.